Last Sunday, we studied verses 31 and 32 in the third chapter, where Krishna speaks of his message being followed by people and getting purity and spiritual growth out of that action. And he also said those who do not follow such a teaching, full of ignorance and delusion, they will be lost in life. That was the idea expressed in the 32nd verse. Ye tvetad abhyasuyanto nanitishthanti me matam sarvajnana vimodhamstan vidhinashtan achetasah. They have no discrimination, they are as good as lost, because they don't accept this teaching by which they can raise their consciousness to higher and higher levels and establish happy relations with all people. This is my teaching. This is, he has said earlier, fix your mind on me. Develop this wonderful attitude of service, control, organic cravings. That is how we develop character. Towards the end of the chapter, we shall study that when we don't do these things, we give a free rein to our native impulses, we become criminals, we suffer. How to overcome that? That is the theme of the last seven verses of this chapter. Verse 33 we study today. Krishna says here, sadrasham cheshtate svasyaha prakrite jnanavanapi prakritim yanti bhutani nigrahakim karishyati. The word prakriti has been used in several of these verses. We call it nature, the whole nature outside. The same nature is within us also. This body, sensory mind complex, is an evolution of the same material out of which external nature also has been evolved. That's the Vedantic teaching, and that's also modern scientific teaching. So nature is also within us, not only outside. Our body, our sensory system, even the psyche, all these are outposts of external nature in you and me. That nature has a great strength within us. We are pulled down by that nature to live like an ordinary animal or beast. We must reckon with this nature. Krishna says here, even a man of knowledge is impelled by nature within to act in particular ways. Sadrisham cheshtate svasyaha. One's own nature dictates how we shall act, what conduct we shall adopt, what behavior we shall adopt. Sadrasham cheshtate svasyaha prakritehe. Prakriti, nature within us, will dictate what we shall do, what we shall not do. Now that prakriti consists of the tendencies of the sensory system to go out all the time, and the mind follows the senses and also go after the sensory world outside. And by doing so, we create another type of nature within us, namely innate tendencies, what we call samskaras, vasanas. They are beautiful scientific terms in our psychology. They are all within the mind. below the conscious level, the subconscious and the unconscious of man. There you find nature in its raw state. Everything is there. And they come out. They try to express. And we are dragged by these forces within. Not only you and I. Jnanavanapi. Even a man of knowledge. He knows everything. Still he is being pulled in a particular direction by these forces. Vedanta wants people to understand what are the forces operating upon us. And Vedanta says two. One external forces, the other internal forces. Most people neglect these internal forces. That is why they are in trouble. If we don't neglect this, we know how to handle these forces, then we can live a better and fuller life. That will be taught in the verses to follow. So, Prakrite Jnanavanapi, even a Jnani, man of knowledge, he is carried away by the forces of nature embedded within oneself. Prakritim Yanti Bhutani, beings follow the impulsions of nature. Nigraha Kim Karishyati, what will mere suppression do? You can't suppress these forces of nature. That is not the way. We have to educate them. As Ramakrishna would say, give them a new direction. All these forces within, mod firiye dao. That is Ramakrishna's Bengali expression. A new direction, ethical, moral, spiritual. You have to give a direction. That is your own responsibility. When you do so, you need help. Then you turn to books like the Gita or the spiritual books. They give you guidance in this matter. And so, it is a problem everybody has to face. Human beings particularly. Animals are all nature. They don't protest against nature. You can see nature in its fullest expression in the animal. But in man, that nature is there. Something else also is there. That something else is his sense of freedom. The Atman manifesting through the body-mind complex has a sense of freedom. I want to change. I want to improve. I want to progress. I take my life in my hand and shape it myself. I don't want nature to shape it. In this way, there is also an element of freedom in every human child, which you won't find in any animal. Vedanta therefore calls this human system as Chit Jada Granthi, a combination of Chit and Jada. That means consciousness and inert matter. These two are combined in the human system. What is inert matter is what nature has implanted within us. What is consciousness is also present within us. In evolution, it has found manifestation in this human system. We are in a difficult situation. We have no struggle if that consciousness was not there. Only nature was there. We say yes to every impulse. But because that consciousness is there, it is tied to this nature, you revolt against it. All moral life, all culture, all civilization comes out of that struggle. I want to assert my own true nature, which is the nature of pure consciousness. So, Chit Jada Granthi, the knot of Chit and Jada. Chit means consciousness, Jada means unconsciousness or inertness. Nature is inert outside. That nature has implanted itself within us. We are a mixture of both. So, when that is strong, we are carried away. Prakrite Jnanavanapi, even a Jnani is subject to this pressure. In the Devi Mahatmyam, that great book of bhakti to the Divine Mother, there is this श्लोक ज्ञानिनाम अपि चेतांसि देवी भगवती हिसा बलादादृश्य मोहाय महामाया प्रयच्छति दैट डिवाइन मदर मैनिफेस्टिंग एज महामाया दैट ग्रेट डेल्यूशन विच इज फंक्शनिंग इन द वर्ल्ड ऑफ मैनिफेस्टेशन ड्रैग्स अवे इवन द माइंड ऑफ ए ज्ञानी टुवर्ड्स डेल्यूशन delusive life, delusive action. And so we have to be careful. Everything is not easy within us. Human life is a struggle. The concept of human life as a struggle is a wonderful concept. Animals do not struggle. We struggle. Their struggle is for mere survival, eating, drinking for survival. Our struggle is not mere survival. Something within us is seeking expression and to dominate this body-mind complex. That is how we develop culture, we develop civilization, saying no to nature, going beyond nature to some extent. But even then, even a man of culture and civilization is subject to the pressures of nature. And you can see it in civilization everywhere. There is a deeper dimension to the subject, not merely civilization. Civilization is only comfort, more of conveniences, more of gadgets. I sometimes quote a sentence from Disraeli, the British Prime Minister of 100 years ago, as a great scholar, where he says, the European talks of progress because by the aid of a few scientific discoveries, he has constructed a society which mistakes comfort for civilization. Because we are more comfortable, we are more civilized. That is our understanding. That's not correct. That's what he wants to emphasize. There is something higher which we have to manifest. Comfortable life is not truly civilized life. So, sadrasham cheshtape sasyaha prakrute jnanavanavi prakritim yanti bhutani. Beings follow impulsions of nature. Nature says do this, you do. Nature says do that also. A man like Jung, Carl Jung of Zurich, psychologist, in his book Modern Man in Search of a Soul also emphasizes this point. There is nature built into us. What all we are doing, nothing but the impulsions of nature. You eat for your physical survival. You get education also to fit yourself for survival. You marry, have children, rear them also. Nature is compelling you to do all these things. In all these matters, what functions is just plain nature, use of that expression, plain nature. But this is not the whole thing. There is such a thing as culture, use of the word nature versus culture, or personality development. There you are on your own ground. You are trying to manifest some dimension within you beyond the nature level. Out of that comes ethics, morality, all higher spiritual life, everything. So he contrasts between these two. Suppose a man is 60 years old. He has enjoyed this world. Then he continues to enjoy another 20 years. And Jung tells him, you are only an instrument of nature. You have not realized your own true dimension. It is high time you do so. Life has two dimensions, forenoon, afternoon. Take your life, divide it into a forenoon and an afternoon. Middle life is the middle line. Formerly it was 35, now you can make it 40, is the middle line. Up to 40, you are in forenoon. What should you do in forenoon? You are busy expressing that impulsions of nature that are within you, how to establish your position in this world. He calls it achievement. What have you achieved? In all this achievement, you are only expressing nature that is within you. Then, after 40, afternoon begins. There must be a different approach, a different philosophy. Don't be an instrument of nature all the time. Be yourself. There is something higher in you. He calls it personality enrichment. He calls it culture. Achievement versus culture. Saying this, he gives a warning. A beautiful sentence. Those who carry over to the afternoon of life the philosophy of the forenoon will be facing disaster. They will become diminutive in personality. They will become smaller and smaller and not bigger and bigger. That is the language. Afternoon has its own philosophy. Forenoon has its own. Don't carry one to the other, because in the afternoon nature is going to neglect us. We are still running after nature. Body is getting weaker and weaker. Why run after the same thing? There are higher things to run after. That is a great lesson. I am sure he must have got it from the Indian idea of the ashramas. Life is divided into four sections: brahmacharya, grahastha, then vanaprastha, sannyasa. The last two deal with the higher dimension in a more concentrated way. During the first two also we shall be having something to do with higher dimension. But the struggle of life is so strong, we can't divert much attention to it. But now that you have achieved something in life, you have got a family, you have got name, fame, everything has come to you. Now it is time to develop a new philosophy for yourself. That's the philosophy of the afternoon. Have I enriched myself qualitatively? What a beautiful concept. More of peace, more of joy, more of compassion. That spiritual development must become the main activity in the afternoon of one's life. If you carry over the afternoon, the forenoon activities to the afternoon, what will be the result? Diminution of personality. You will become smaller, smaller and smaller day by day, because the world rejects you. Nature rejects you. You are not fit for nature. Take for example the concept of genetics. Any organism is valuable for nature only so long as it can reproduce. As soon as it ceases to reproduce, nature has no interest in that organism. That is the nature of this philosophy. But nature may reject you. But why do you reject yourself? You have the capacity to take life to a higher level, higher than nature. Don't live at the nature's level all the time. This is a profound truth. In these verses, Gita is stressing this idea that much of our life is at the level of nature. We accept it, but it did not always be so. We can rescue ourselves from the bonds of nature. There is something within us which is free. We can manifest that freedom. There comes a higher philosophy of life, and both these do not contradict. They follow one after the other. First is achievement, certainly. Jung says, a young man of 20, instead of sitting quiet, looking into the navel, sitting in meditation, let him work hard, let him earn, let him do this and that. Otherwise, he will be a failure. So achievement is the first lesson we have to learn. But that's not the only lesson, he says. There is a higher lesson. In these verses, you get that truth expressed by Sri Krishna. Sadrasham cheshtate svasyaha pragateha. Svasyaha pragateha sadrasham. According to one's own pragati or nature, we act. Even a jnani is supposed to act accordingly. Nigraha kim karishyati. What can mere suppression of these do? If you suppress it here, it will come out that way. That's why, as a famous Roman poet of the Augustan period, 1st century AD, Horace, he says, if you take nature by a pitchfork and throw it out through the window, it will come in through the door. You cannot destroy that nature. It is there, but you must know how to handle it. The best psychology has been used to develop the spiritual message of Vedanta. Without doing violence to human nature, this nature which is always expressing, we slowly educate that nature and go higher and higher and higher. No direct confrontation, no suppression. Suppression has no meaning at all, because suppressed energies find a way to come out. In fact, they come out in a disguised form. That's one of the big contributions of Freud to human psychology. Whatever is unpleasant to you, whatever your conscience doesn't like, you just suppress it into the mind. It goes into the subconscious or unconscious. From there, it comes out in a disguised form, in various forms of psychic distortions and complexes manifesting as this behavior, that behavior. You don't know what they are. A psychologist or a psychoanalyst may be able to know better. And so he analyzes and traces it to that suppressed energy which has created this distortion. So he says, that is not the way. Educate these things. They can be educated. Ramakrishna puts it in that simple statement, mod phiriye dao, turn the direction of these energies. They are all centers of energy. Every emotion is a center of energy. Every psychic experience is a center of energy. That energy has to be refined and given a direction. That capacity we have. Only we must do it carefully, judiciously, not a direct confrontation. Those who have enormous spiritual strength, they can do with a confrontation with these forces. But most people cannot and should not. They will lose in the battle. That's the meaning of the statement, Nigraha kim karishyati, merely suppressing. What can it do? Better to work out these various tendencies, impulses, with a discriminating mind, so that you can go higher and higher. The word discrimination comes here again and again. So this is the teaching regarding nature implanted in man, the same nature. That's why he will say there is a similarity between the two, attraction between the two, nature outside and my sensory and psychic system. That he will say later on. He says, next shloka, 34. Indriyasya indriyasya arthe ragadveshau vyavasthitau tayorna vashamagacche tauhyasya paripanthinau. Indriya, indriyasya artha, two words. Indriya means sense organ. Indriyasya artha, the object, namely sense object, sensory object. These two are related to each other. Indriyasya, indriyasya arthe. How do they get related? Through two emotions. One is called raga, the other is called dvesha. If it is favorable, I am attached to it. If it is unfavorable, I get angry with it. These are the ways we react to all external sensory experiences. A pleasant experience, we welcome. Unpleasant, we try to run away from. That is how we behave with regard to the external sensory world. Indriyasya, indriyasya arthe, raga dveshau, raga means attachment, craving, dvesha. If you don't get what you seek, you get angry. Or if you get something bad, also you get angry. Raga dveshau, vyavasthitau, they are well established. This sensory system is well established in the sensory world through these two emotions, raga and dvesha. Raga dveshau, vyavasthitau. Then Krishna says, tayor navashamagachehe, don't get into their clutches, the language. Tayorna vasham means clutches. Don't get into their clutches. Why? Tauhyasya paripanthinau. they are in this life highway robbers. See the language, paripanthi. Now you are going in the road, a highway robber comes, loots away whatever you have. Therefore be careful, be careful. Thou hast yet paripanthi. Now we have plenty of highway robbers today in buses and rails everywhere, but every day in our life we are having this kind of highway robbers. What do they rob from us? Our discrimination, our knowledge, our wisdom, all these things are robbed away. Therefore be careful, be alert in the language. Tayorna vashamagachehe taushyasya paripanthinau. They are the enemies of this man, this human being. Paripanthi means enemy, but particularly without any warning an enemy comes. That's called highway robbery. You are going carelessly, somebody comes and robs you away. Paripanthinau. So this is a warning that is given to all wayfarers in life. We are all wayfarers. We have started our life as a baby, going on in this world as a pilgrim to achieve this and that. To all of us, this warning is given. If you want your life to be successful, be careful. These robbers are there. You cannot be careless in your journey. Then, Shreyan Sadharmo Vigunaha Paradharmat Svanushthitat Sadharme Nidhanam Shreya Paradharmo Bhayavaha. Everyone has his own dharma. According to your psychological disposition, you have a particular bent of mind and bent of conduct and behavior. That is your dharma. He says, better to die in one's own dharma than to live in somebody else's dharma. That is good for him, this is good for you. Find out your own dharma, your own quality, your own mental disposition. That makes for your dharma. So this we have to understand. Shreyan Satarmo Vigunaha. Even though my dharma is not so much up to the mark, is not all good, still it is better for me than somebody else's dharma. So better to die in one's own dharma. The dharma of somebody else will be dangerous for you. This is a teaching based on the individuality of every one of us. There is an individual, just like for example we have got the thumb impression. Everybody has his own thumb impression. That is his individuality. Similarly, there is a psychic individuality. That is the bend of life. Certain attitudes, certain reactions, certain likes and dislikes, all these constitute our personality. Let us not imitate somebody else. Let us be ourselves. Don't be shy. Don't be ashamed to be yourself. Don't try to imitate somebody else or somebody else's conduct and behavior. You can learn from people, but imitation is not necessary. You be yourself. So this shloka refers to this need on our part to have faith in oneself, confidence in oneself, in one's own psychological disposition, and develop yourself in that line so that you will be developing yourself, not cast into the mold of somebody else. Shreyan Satarmo Vigunaha Paradharmat Svanushthitat Sadharme Nidhanam Shreya Paradharmo Bhayavaha. Other dharma is full of fear. Bhayavaha, not at all fit for you. That is fit for that person in that way. This is the text up to this verse 35. Then comes this question. How do we commit blunders in life? Crime, sin, all these things we do. What is the etiology of crime? A very important subject comes in this third chapter where we discussed with Prakriti, all these things, nature within, nature outside, and Kama and Krodha, all these we discussed. So Arjuna is putting a very pertinent question at this stage. Here is the question. Arjuna Uvacha. अथ केन प्रयुक्तोयम् पापं चरति पुरुषः अनिच्छन्नपि वार्ष्णेय बलादिव नियोजितः. दिस् इस् अ क्वेश्चन् विच् एव्री वन् आफ् यू मस्ट् बि पुटिङ्ग् एव्री नौ एण्ड् देन् सैलेण्ट्लि इन् युवर् मैण्ड्. अर्जुन इस् ओन्ली ए साम्पल् आफ् वाट् ह्युमानिटि ईस्. अर्जुन सेस् बै वाट् इम्पल्शन् डस् मेन् कमिट् क्रैम्. अथ केन प्रयुक्तोऽयम्, केन मीन्स् वाट्, प्रयुक्त मीन्स् इम्पेल्ड् बै, पापं चरति, वि कमिट् सिन्, क्रैम्, ईविल्, पुरुषः, ह्यूमन् बीङ्ग्स्. पापं वि जनरलि ट्रान्स्लेट् एस् सिन्. इन् थियोलजि पापं मीन्स् सिन्. इन् सोशियो पोलिटिकल् थाट् पापं मीन्स् क्रैम्. Crime against society, crime against other human beings or other beings, that's called crime. Crime against God is called papam in the sense of sin. But in Vedanta, we don't make much distinction between the two, sin and crime. The question therefore is, why does man commit a crime or an evil deed like theft, murder, so many other things? In fact, we have got plenty of varieties of crime today, multiplying day by day. So it is good to know the origin of this crime. Etiology is a deep psychological study. In fact, in sociology we study this subject, and also in criminology we study this subject. Psychologically it is a wonderful study. What is the origin of crime? Not only so, the last line says, Baladiva Niyojitaha. I don't want to do it, but something impels me towards it. That's also mentioned there. Left to oneself, I don't think we shall commit crime, but some force in me forces me to do the crime. What is that? This is our everyday experience. So these seven verses are a depth study of the subject of crime, its etiology, and how to overcome it. All that is included in these seven verses. So anichchannapi, even though I don't like to do that crime, baladiva niyojitaha, somebody is forcing me, just like a superior man forcing an inferior man to do something wrong. He can't say no to it. We are also like that. Within us, we are two personalities. One is the good man, wants to be moral, wants to be good. There is somebody else also who is creating this trouble, impelling me. There is a multidimensional, not even two, multidimensional you can say. Human being is a very complex entity. So this subject comes up here. Atakena prayuktoyam papam charati purushaha. I am purushaha. This Mr. So-and-so, this Mrs. So-and-so, I am purushaha. By what impulsion does he or she commit crime or sin in spite of oneself? As if some force is forcing him or her to do this. That is Arjuna's question. Bhagavan Uvacha, Shri Krishna is giving the reply. Kama esha, krodha esha, rajoguna samudbhavaha, mahashano mahapatma, vidhi enam iha vairinam. Who are these enemies who impel you towards crime, towards evil? Very clear. Kama and Krodha, two energies within, they impel us towards this evil and sin. Kama esha, Krodha esha. It is Kama, it is Krodha. Kama is a great word. It has been treated from two points of view. In Manusmriti, there is a great praise of Kama. If you have no karma within, you can't act at all. All action is impelled by karma. So karma is praised there. Akamasya kriya nasti, says Manu. A man who has no desire, he doesn't act also. We want to put desire into the mind of the person so that he may act well. Take our own rural population. Millions of them, they have no desire within. They are living in dirt, no education. Even though school is there, they don't go. They have absolutely no desire. Can we say they have become great sages? Not at all. The first lesson is to stimulate desire. In a young child, you stimulate desire. Then only activity will come. I want something. I must work for it, struggle for it, prepare myself to achieve it. So the first stage is karma. Similarly, krodha. Sometimes you need krodha. I had occasion to say earlier how human life will be very dull without this emotion called krodha or anger. They have a place, but they need regulation. They are blind forces. There comes human education, including religion. For religion is the higher education. And so, at some stage, we have to say no to karma. We have to say no to krodha. Then only you can live in a society of millions of people. If I am alone on an island, I don't need to control and restrain my karma and krodha. I can go on all over the island, run about whatever I like, go and take, get angry with everything that is there against rocks and other trees, you can do. There is no worry at all. Because there are other human beings on whom your karma and krodha will react, therefore there is need for checking these two forces. That is why when you do not check, then they become evil. If you check them, they are not evil. Remember this meaning of the word karma. In this very book, a few chapters later, Sri Krishna will tell us, I am the karma in the heart of all beings, but a karma unopposed to dharma, unopposed to ethical sense. Any karma which is unopposed to ethical sense is divine, is welcome. See the language. Dharma aviruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshabha Arjuna. And that karma in all beings which is unopposed to dharma. If my karma doesn't oppose your interest, the interest of other people in society, there is no harm in it. Absolutely, it is fine. So, karma is not condemned all through, but unrestricted karma, unrestrained karma, also krodha, also other evils coming along with them. These are primary. Our philosophy speaks of six enemies of man. Every human being has six enemies. They are all inside. First is karma. Karma, krodha, lobha. Lobha is greed. Earning is good, but greed is bad. Karma, krodha, lobha. Moha, delusion. Mada, pride and arrogance. Matsarya, violence. These things are known as shad ripu, six enemies of every human being. Man alone can tackle them. Animals cannot tackle this subject. So our philosopher has discovered these six enemies, of which these two are the most important and most dangerous. Once these are controlled, other four are easy to control. So he says, Krishna says, what is that force that impels me to do wrong, to commit sin? They are two, kama esha, krodha esha. What is their origin? Beautiful psychological study. Rajoguna samudbhavaha. They are born from the rajoguna that is within you. Rajas. First is tamas, inertia. When you are in tamas, you neither do good nor do wrong. Yes, this table and chair, they are all tamas. They don't do any good or bad. There is no judgment of good and bad there, so long as tamas is there. As soon as rajas comes, then it can be either bad or good. So these are coming from the rajasic nature that is within us. And I said, we do need to educate a child from tamas to rajas, to create karma in that child. I want this, I want that, I want that. If there is an obstruction, I shall try to remove it with all my energy. So kama krodha become utilized for human development there. So six enemies, of which these are two. These two arise from rajoguna. That rajoguna which has not been properly disciplined by the person concerned. He is going to tell us something about that rajoguna and the discipline that we have to apply to the rajoguna. Rajoguna samudbhavaha. Mahashano, mahapapma. Two beautiful words. Mahashana. These two energies, kama and krodha, born of rajoguna, they are big eaters. Ashana means eating. Maha means great. Big eaters. That means like fire. You put fuel. Go on putting any amount of fire. Fire will be very happy. Any amount of fuel you put, the mahashana. This is also the same. You satisfy desire, go on, go on, go on. They will always say more, 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 more. That is the nature of desire in man. Last time I quoted the beautiful passage from Goethe's Faust, that drama, German dramatist, where Faust is sitting alone in the forest and entering into a soliloquy, talking to oneself. Lass, I see our own fulfillment. You light a fire in my heart. That fire burns till from desire I stumble to possession, and in possession languish from desire. That is my fate today. That's the language he has used. There you can see Mahashano. Desires are endless. As soon as you satisfy one, 10 will rise in their place. That is what Schopenhauer said. You satisfy one, 10 will rise in their place. 100 will rise. That is the nature of desire. So Mahashano. Today we refer to this in the economic language as need and greed. Human needs we can satisfy. Human greed you cannot satisfy. In this world there are enough resources to satisfy the needs of all the 4 billion humanity, but not the greed. Greed cannot be satisfied. If greed comes, millions of people have to go without the elementary needs. That is the difficulty of this modern age. Economists, philosophers and thinkers are stressing this point today, that we should contain this greed, what you call consumerism mania. That must go, because it is endless. Mahashano, beautiful word. Many writers criticize America, for example, that 7% people of the world consume 40% of the world's resources. That's America. Americans themselves make this criticism. These are good signs. We are trying to understand the human situation better and better, that there is enough to meet the needs of people, not enough to meet the greeds of even a small number of people. So nature becomes destroyed. All ecological balance becomes disturbed because of greed. Take for example birds. How many birds have become extinct? Because we go hunting them and take their feathers, put on our heads. How many birds have gone extinct? There was a bird in Mauritius, dodo. Up to 200 years ago it was there. Colonial people went there, went on shooting them out. It's a very heavy bird, can't fly quickly. So it is extinct today. That's why in English we say dead as dodo. A thing is dead as dodo. Dodo has completely disappeared from the world. So in this way, ecological balance, which is needed for human survival, becomes disturbed by greed. So where a need is concerned, there is no difficulty at all. So the word Mahajana is a wonderful word. It is relevant to what we think of human situation today. Number one, Mahajana. Mahapapma, second word, which will impel you to do much evil, much destruction. That's called Mahapapma. Sin, evil, crime, all come from these two forces. Kama, Krodha, coming from Rajoguna. Therefore, Mahapapma, how many evils we are doing based on Kama and Krodha. So, two wonderful words, Mahashano, Mahapapma. Then Krishna says, Vidhyenam Iha Vairinam Iha. In this world, in this human life, Enam, this Vidhi, no Vairinam, as your enemy. This is our enemy. Kama and Krodha, because of this nature, they take you in the wrong side. They make you a nuisance to yourself and nuisance to others as well. So this Kama Esha, Krodha Esha, Rajoguna Samudbhavaha, Mahashano, Mahapapma, Vidhi Enam Iha Vairinam. This Rajas in man, full of energy, I must have this, I must have this, work hard. What you call that go ahead type of people, always ambitious, 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 going on, destroying everybody on the way. You can see raw Rajas operating in such a person. They commit lot of crime because to satisfy one's ambition, we have to be unscrupulous. Scruples will stand in the way of ambition. So you become unscrupulous. I am quoting the Harvard psychology professor McDougall that any young person must have a certain ideal of human excellence before his mind. Then if he has ambition, that ambition will do no harm to him. That will be moderated by that ideal of excellence before him. If that ideal is not there, only ambition, he must become unscrupulous, because scruples will stand in the way of realizing his ambition. These are his words. So when this rajas becomes strong, then it takes us on that wrong track of personal ambition, unconcerned with everybody else. Therefore it becomes Mahashano, Mahapapma. Lot of evil comes out of that. We are seeing it every day. Sometimes, now just now, two people are arrested for espionage in Delhi, giving secrets to foreign powers. Now they are in jail. They must be thinking, what a fate it is. But how did they get in there? Because of this tremendous rajas, nothing to moderate it, nothing to refine it, and just go straight ahead and get into trouble as well. Hundreds of instances are there. We see every day around us. It is good to think about this, and this chapter, these seven verses, will help everyone to think deeply how we can handle the rajas that is within us. The answer will come. Krishna will give it later. Moderate this rajas with a touch of sattva. Give it a higher dimension. Refine it. Then something great will happen. The same energy will bring blessing to hundreds of people through you. That is what doesn't happen when Kama and Krodha become connected with one's own individual self, its own welfare, its own happiness. So Mahashano, Mahapapma, Vidhi Enam Iha Vairinam. Enam means this. Vidhi, no. Vairi, enemy. Iha, in this life, in this world. That is the first answer. The next one is an illustration. There is the divine spark in all of us. Until you hide it, you can't do evil. So we try, by our ignorance and delusion, we hide it, then get into evil ways. But hiding is mentioned. Knowledge is hidden by something. Therefore, we commit blunder. Just like Mahabharata said, when you walk in darkness, you may tumble into a pit, you may run over some brambles, because it's darkness around you. If you have a light, you don't have that trouble. But that light is hidden in darkness here, in delusion here. So he says, Dhumena avriyate vannihi yatha adarsho malena cha yatholbhena avrato garbha tatha tenaitam avratam. Three examples are given. This knowledge in man, this discriminatory capacity is hidden in man. How? Just like Dhumena avriyate vannihi. Here is fire covered in smoke. Nothing but smoke. So fire is there. You see only the dark smoke there. Dhumena avriyate vannihi. Similarly, yatha adarsho malena cha. A beautiful mirror. You can't see your face. Full of dirt on it. Similarly, is this human knowledge hidden by these evil forces. And thirdly, yatholpena avrato garbha. The baby inside the womb is hidden by the amniotic sac, that covering, membrane. It is hidden there. Three examples are given. Tatha teneta mahavratam. Similarly, this knowledge is hidden by this rajoguna, expressing as kama and krodha. Having said this, the next shloka expressly states the jnana that is within man. He says, wonderful verse, avratam jnana metena jnanino nitya vairina. This jnana in man is hidden, is covered over by this. By what? This kama and krodha arising from rajas, which is man's nitya vairi, eternal enemy. Unrestrained kama and krodha are man's eternal enemy. Nitya vairi is the word used here, not only for a day, but throughout. So, avratam jnanametena, jnanino, man of knowledge has his eternal enemy in these two forces working within him. They hide this jnana, and the jnana is hidden. He does all sorts of evil, all sorts of blunder. Kama rupena kaunteya, which is that enemy that hides kama, this wonderful unrestrained pursuit of personal pleasure and satisfaction. Kama rupena kaunteya dushpurena analena cha. It is like a fire which is never satisfied with the fuel that you throw on it. The more you throw, the fire says, we want more, we want more. Dushpurena analena cha. Unsatisfied fire. In spite of all the wood that you put, it is still unsatisfied. So also is the state of the human mind. Avratam jnanametena jnanino nitya vairina kamarupena kaunteya dushpurena analena cha. This is the teaching by Krishna on this subject of etiology of crime. But we want how to get out of it. How can we be free from this crime and the tendency to crime? That will come in the remaining three or four verses, which we shall take up next Sunday, as usual.